Okay, I think we're about ready to get started. Good afternoon, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, I think we're about ready to get started. First of all, I want to welcome everybody here today. Feel free to come on in, take a seat. I'd ask everybody to make themselves comfortable. Have a seat. I just finished a two-week journey through the eastern part of this country with a civil rights museum on wheels, and we explored the positive and sometimes troublesome history of this country with civil rights. But it was a wonderful journey. We got to hear a lot from people who had really struggled to make this country free, and it was a blessing to see how this nation has turned to this day its sometimes difficult past in acknowledging people's rights into a very positive thing. But as I was doing that journey, I figured after 2 weeks I deserved a little R&R. And I went with my family. I met them in Disney World. And it was well-deserved and much appreciated. And Disney is just a remarkable company in terms of its ability to really hone in on certain messages and hone in on the consumer, the customer. And as I was walking through Disney, I came across this quote, which I think is particularly fitting, and it was from Mr. Disney himself. He said, "You don't build it for yourself. You learn what the people want and what they desire, and you build it for them." In that spirit, I think the members of the committee, special committee, have learned what the people want and desire. And I might add, not everybody desires this. In a democracy, that's the great thing about this country and taking this trip. The diversity of this nation allows us to have differences of opinion about things. But what is clear from my reading of the report is people want and desire this. Not everybody, but there are people who want and desire this. And it is my hope and my fervent prayer that we build it for them. In that regard, before finding out what the people desire and what the people want and hearing about that, I want to do what I think is always appropriate. Thank the committee, Mr. Baxter, Mr. Colonel Miranda, for putting their time and effort into this matter, and all the volunteers to the committee. Again, learning what people want and desire is a difficult thing. And doing it with honesty and integrity is even more challenging. Because if you read that report, it's not just about what people want, it's also about what people don't want. And that's the beauty of this country. And that's the beauty of this document. It doesn't just, it's not a one-sided document. It says everybody wants this. And I challenge anybody to come across a document with this much integrity that really desire to understand what people want and what people desire. And I'm glad to read. I feel very good that this document also includes some dissenting opinions. And that's a good thing. That's what we fight for, not just those of us in uniform, but all of us. That's what we fight for, the ability to hear different opinions, good and bad, pro and con. And I'm very blessed and very encouraged and very thankful that you have taken the time to solicit everyone's opinion. And I also would be remiss if I didn't thank Deborah Flanagan. You know, there are so many people in this building that work behind the scenes that the camera doesn't focus on them, and they're really doing the bulk of the work. And so while Deborah won't say anything today, she said it all by her work. And I know the members of the special committee and the members of the Board of Education really appreciate your work, Deborah. And we can't thank you enough for that. And we could all give Deborah a round of applause. At this point, I would ask Chief or Mr. Baxter to come on up and say a few words, and then he'll be followed by Colonel Miranda.
Thank you, sir. Well, it's been quite the honor to be part of this committee and
by no means do I have a stake in it any further than being one of the co-chairs, but it's been an honor to learn more about the education system and learn about the great people we have at the school district. And with that being said, we did a comprehensive study, and we're very proud of this report we're publishing today. We spoke to key leaders in the community, both political, union, key leaders that would have a stake in the educational fields that might realize some of these students that we're hopefully going to challenge to go on to higher education. We talked to people from all walks of life, and with that, we wrote a comprehensive report that you're going to see today, and we're very proud of that comprehensive report for exactly what Mr. Van White was saying. We took everybody's opinion and put that into one very well-written, we hope, report. And with that being said, it has multiple facets to it. It's got a plan A, what we think is the best plan, but it also has a plan B, plan C, that we're going to challenge the school board, if we will, to take all the information we have and choose what you think is best as you go through your vetting system. I have to personally say thank you to the school board and Mr. Van White. This is a bold step just to take this study, right? It wasn't easy, and it came with some, if you will, consenting or dissenting opinions. But just to take the bold step and not do the same old, same old. I was a graduate of this high school system in 1983, and if it wasn't for the United States Army, I don't think I'd be standing here today with all the blessings I've had in my life. There's few things that influence me more than the United States Army, and it's not for everybody. I realize that. I have lots of friends, and I also have a 17-year-old son that's looking to go in the military. So I don't take military service lightly, and I don't take the current war lightly, but I do take it as another great option for American kids to look at as a potentiality where they want to go in their future. The committee, Mr. Van White hit on it. We can share the names. They're in the report. These are all volunteers. We're there to 9 o'clock many Wednesday nights, just digging into data and digging into information. And I can guarantee you a lot of arguments going back and forth about ideas and concepts. It was not a yes, sir, no, sir committee. And there was dissenting opinions. And we use those as challenges to make sure we're vetting out our information as appropriately as possible. So I got to thank the committee members for that. They spent their time with us and spent hours with us. And with that, we got a well-rounded report. To share the report, it's my honor to turn over to a person with many titles, professor, colonel, doctor, but we'll call him Lieutenant Colonel Miranda today, that's going to share the actual report and my co-chair. Thank you, sir.
A military school in Rochester, the first military high school in Rochester, New York, is not only feasible, but also desirable. This is the conclusion of the committee that was charged specifically 60 days ago to answer the guiding question. The recommendations contained in this report detail what we feel is the best plan for a military school in Rochester, a co-ed, standalone program educating grades 7 through 12 when filled to capacity, drawing students regionally from all of Monroe County and surrounding areas, with a majority of students coming from the Rochester City School District. The committee did not review or recommend any specific locations or buildings as a site for this first military high school. However, the committee listed alternative plans with each recommendation. Because we considered alternate courses of action, we regard this report as a living document that can be used consistently through the planning stages of making this school a reality within the Rochester City School District. The subcommittees came together as a grand committee every other week to develop recommendations for the organizational structure of the military school based upon historical data and lessons learned from other military schools around the country, as well as considering input from the greater Rochester community. To elaborate on these significant data gathering methods, I'd like to ask Ms. Mary Courtney, who was the chair of the community input subcommittee, to briefly discuss the process that informed our committee's decisions and findings. Ms. Mary Courtney.
In seeking community input on a possible military school, we conducted both a community survey and student survey. To collect the student data, we sent requests to principals within RCSD middle and high schools and to superintendents of all school districts in Monroe County, as well as to school leaders of private and charter schools. We solicited community input by announcement through the media, thank you, as well as direct requests to various community organizations, church groups, civic organizations, and parent organizations. The community survey resulted in 653 responses, while there were approximately 200 student responses. Overall, in the community survey, 70% of the respondents supported the idea of a military school. 24% were opposed, 5% were undecided. Student survey showed 67% in favor, 33% opposed. We broke down the community data by city and suburban residents and found higher levels of support among Monroe County residents outside the city than in the city. 83% support in the county, 54% support in the city. Considering only parents within the city and Monroe County, the results were essentially the same as when we considered the full community response. Other major indicators from the survey indicate that the community is interested in a regional model school, with 79% of community respondents favoring a regional approach. Student data was essentially the same result, with 80% favoring a regional approach. Finally, respondents were asked whether they would send their own children to a military school. Of the 500 respondents who answered the question as a parent, 232 said they would be interested in sending their child to a military school. 91 from within the city, 101 from Monroe County, 25 from the greater Rochester area outside of Monroe County, and a handful from even farther away than that. Of the 200 student replies, 42%, 73 of those 200 students, indicated they would have been interested in attending a military school if it had been an option for them. In addition to the survey, we conducted focus groups with parents, educators, students, community, business, and church and nonprofit members, as well as the military community. During the focus groups, we had people representing every viewpoint imaginable in the spectrum, from those who think a military school is the best idea ever and want to know how soon it will be open, to those who think a military school is the worst idea the district has ever considered. The focus group discussions among these people were incredibly open and respectful, with people clearly expressing their support as well as their concerns about the proposal. All of these voices are captured within the report. The full survey results can be found in detail in Appendix F of the report.
Thank you, Ms. Courtney. Considering the academic program, the committee recommends a rigorous Regents course of study focusing on college prep, including 4 years of math, sciences, history, and English, with a physical education program encompassing extracurricular sports, activities of unique, low-cost, minimal injury, individual development sports such as fencing, jiu-jitsu, and rowing that will enable the cadet student scholars and the school to truly excel. Music, arts, and technology were proposed as essential elements of school programming, including a drum and bugle corps, and Project Lead the Way. Finally, the backbone of the military school will be the JROTC program, including and not excluding all students, regardless of their physical limitations or abilities. Through the program recommendations, the committee feels students will lead students and will mentor underclassmen, and students will be responsible for developing the follower leader model, mentor model for the military school cadet. Our committee, composed of members in expressing diverse opinions regarding military schools in the Rochester City School District, at the start of this study, carefully analyzed the information collected in our comprehensive work and reached this final conclusion. First, I want to thank those listed on the inside front cover of the report for the many hours of work that they provided for the good of the committee and for the ultimate good of the students within Rochester City School District. Todd and I were humbled by your professionalism and unselfish devotion to community service. Committee members, I really want to applaud your work. It's great. Thank you. The report itself was developed by meeting together as a grand committee every other Wednesday through the 60-day period. At the first meeting, subcommittees were formed with a lead member charged with the responsibility of meeting as many times as necessary to draft recommendations for the subcommittee reports. The four subcommittees were budget, community interest, input, curriculum and school type, and legal. Each member was given the choice to select the subcommittee that they would like to serve on and where they felt they could contribute most extensively. Once members selected their subcommittees, the leads with their members conducted the work. During each grand committee meeting, the subcommittees and their leads reported their progress to the group. The information from the subcommittees were incorporated into this final report. During the final grand committee meeting, the 11 recommendations contained in the report were agreed upon by all members in attendance. At the final meeting, a writing team was appointed by the group as the final report writing team. The subcommittee leads provided final reports of their work to be incorporated into the final report. The writing team met 3 times to finalize the final report, which was then sent by Mr. Baxter to all committee members for their approval. The leads, in particular, were asked this important question: does the final report reflect the intent of your work? Following input and approval by committee members, the report writers finalized the report. Todd Baxter and I approved the final report, and this was the sequence of how the report was written: transparent, involving all community members, and comprehensively written. As co-chairs, Todd and I feel that the report is a product that is a good balance of an unbiased thought process, where all committee members had repeated opportunities to contribute to the final report and the voice of objectors and the concerns of community members are contained in the final report. One key Rochester community leader expressed the results of this committee perhaps the best. The Rochester City School District continues to consider every opportunity for our students. With this first military high school initiative, more students will be offered the unique opportunities available in a loving, caring, yet disciplined military public school environment. As such, there are families, parents, and students that have substantiated our finding that a military academy is not only feasible, but also desirable in Rochester, New York. At this time, this concludes our report of the study, and Todd and I and the committee members would be happy to address your questions. Todd, would you like to come up with me?
Sir.
Yep. Yes, sir.
I'd be happy to address that. Yeah, that was one of the initial thoughts that came up, and we needed to vet that out as quick as possible. We don't want to be a pipeline for the military. We want to give military discipline, the military education, and let the individual, the parents and the individual, make that choice of what they want to do with the rest of their life. One of the things that we did find out as we went to the higher educations, for instance, RIT and U of R, providing free education to every graduate from the city school district, yet there's only 16 kids attending the RIT today via that program. That's our pipeline. You know, we want to feed that. We want to feed the vocational schools, Monroe Community College, for example, and those great jobs that are out there just waiting for these young men and women to take over. We know we got that gap there in our local industries. And then the military is always a great option, and I wouldn't lie about that. I'm proud of my military service. So, but to say it's a pipeline, we were very cautious about that, very transparent about that. Is that an option? That's an option parents and kids will make the choice of. But I see a lot of these kids also going here and being fantastic students at RIT, U of R. I see a lot of professors going, wow, this is the student I've been waiting for and looking for a long time, with that discipline, self-discipline, study habits, and all those built in. So we did look at that. We did vet that out. And I would absolutely categorically say it's not a pipeline to. As a matter of fact, we got the lead recruiter here, and he was very making sure we weren't going down that road.
The other thing I would point out, Lynette, is that if you look at the national data, less than 10% of students who go to military academies actually end up going into the military. So the data, it does not suggest for schools that have opened up that students automatically go into the military. Generally speaking, overwhelmingly, they do not. As Todd says, this is opening the door to opportunity. And if you drive the city streets, I used to be a prosecutor. If you drive the city streets, if you're a law enforcement officer, if you're an employer, you see a lack of hope, a lack of opportunity. And all we're saying is this not an opportunity to open up the door of hope? That's it. It's just one door. There are many doors. This is just one door. Any other questions? We'll get to you all, but I want to make sure that the media has asked questions first.
All right, so we have this report. What's the next step? What's the next order?
The board has... I'm sorry. The board has a series of committees. We have 5 committees. One of them is excellent student achievement, and that's a teaching and learning committee. They look at the substance of what is being taught in the classrooms in our buildings. And then there's a finance committee. Generally speaking, the vetting process would include this proposal going before each of those committees and board members on those committees and convening maybe hearings, talking to the members of the special committee about their report. So there'll be a vetting of the report. There may be some additional process that is included beyond the committees, because recently the law came into play that basically in New York State and the federal government require community-based schools. I have no doubt that this group has done its due diligence in identifying where the community support could come from, but there may be, in addition to the committee process, there may be an additional vetting process that the board develops to make sure that this is organic in its nature, that it comes from this community, is indeed wanted by this community. And then once that process is complete, it would go before the full board for a final vote on whether to proceed. I got to tell you, by way of example, when the board initiated the process that created the EPO at East High School, that process, that planning process, lasted a year. And during that year process, it could have conceivably happened that it didn't happen. But it did, as you all know. But we believe that any good idea is worth deliberating over. There'll be many, many, many more conversations with people in the community about this idea if the board decides to go forward.
So then what would happen? The board approves it?
If the board approved it, after going through that vetting process, then, of course, there'd have to be a budget set aside for it. There'd have to be staff that would man the program, staff the program. So a school would be created. Now, we don't, again, they've made a couple different, given us a couple different options. Could it be a traditional public school? It is my hope that it would be, and that would require a different set of protocols. Could it be a charter school? Could it be an EPO? We don't know. There's much to be, and that's why you need that year planning period. So I don't, to answer your question, Lynette, I don't know what happens beyond the point where the board says, okay, we vetted it through those two committees, we've let the community sort of savor the moment and figure out whether it's something that they want and add something to it, and then the board says, hypothetically, thumbs up. I don't know what that thumbs up looks like, because they're making a series of recommendations. I don't know what could come out of it. But ultimately, if you use the EPO as an example, once we finish that year vetting process, there was a budget that had to be submitted, and the school opened up in September 2015. My guess would be if, and please quote me on the word if the board approves this, I don't see this happening before. If we're going to do our due diligence and it's really going to work and be meaningful, create those doors of opportunity, it couldn't open before September 2017. If we're really doing our due diligence, talking to people in the community, making sure we have the right people of staffing this and manning this and moving it forward, it couldn't happen credibly, effectively, before September 2017.
You recommended a standalone program. Can you talk a little bit about that standalone program? School, in fact, I think is the word.
So there were a couple of different models that we could look at. We could do a standalone school that had its own beds code. Right, that would be like an East or an Edison, which would be one model. But what we looked at instead was a program school, which is, you could use the model of All City High School right now. It's a program school that takes students from other schools, where the students would retain their identity to their home school. So you can be a senior from East High School who is attending All City High School. All right. When they graduate, they are still a graduate of East High School, but they can attend that program at All City. So our recommendation, our first recommendation, was that we do it as a program school. It's faster to start up. It gives more flexibility in terms of, you know, if a student comes into the school and tries it and it's not for them, I think the path would be easier to go back to their home school. And they could retain that identity with their home school. They could retain their sports through their home school. So we think it would give a way to start the school while maintaining the integrity of other schools within the district and allow the maximum amount of flexibility.
Lynette, I would add to to what Mary said. If a separate school is created, she mentioned a beds code, that would require, after we went through the vetting process of our committees and then went to the community and the board decided to do this, we would have to have, if we chose that model, the approval of the State Department of Education before we could open up such a school. The program school that she described would not require that.
I'll add one other thing. In this report, you'll see different options, Plan A, Plan B, Plan C. So this was just our Plan A, and that's why this is such a living document, because things can change. And that way, this can be carried forward.
But this is your recommendation, though, the program.
Standalone. Mm-hmm.
So how would it be funded? Would it be like a charter school where, like she was saying, the students keep their own identity, so those tax dollars from their respective school district would flow into the academy, or how would that work?
Well, when Mary described All City, I think you use All City as an example. No, those dollars are internal dollars. So a student who is at Edison, who for some reason has to go to All City High, that those dollars stay with that student within the district. So All City is not a charter school, it's a program school, right? If we were to create a separate school, a new school that didn't exist before, we'd have to have a new beds code, and then Commissioner Elia would have to say, yes, I give the thumbs up to your proposal. And even then, if you're talking about the financing side of it, the students would be district students. If a student were, here's the interesting thing, I don't know if this is where you're going, but if a student from Brighton, and I suspect there'll be the share, there's a share of students from Brighton, Pittsford, and Riga, whose parents, not Van White, not Superintendent Simmons, not Todd Baxter, whose parents decide, they know their child, they want their child to attend this school, what you would have is the reverse urban-suburban, right? We don't have that in the district. Usually, our students are trying to go to the suburban districts. I dare say this might be the first time, one of the very rare times that we see suburban students wanting to come to a city school. If that were to happen, there would be the funding would follow the student from the suburbs to the city. We don't see that happen too much. I look forward to the day, without regard to what you call it, I look forward to the day that this district is a district that people want to come to. That would be a paradigm shift. And that's something I think we all should rejoice in. I'm going to get to you folks, but I just want to make sure the media that, and they're on a bit of a time frame. Any other questions from the media?
So then who would get preference in terms of being selected? Would it be open to students outside of Rochester?
Well, Lynette, we're so far away from that. I can't answer that with any specificity, but man, what a great dilemma that would be for this district to have to decide, oh my gosh, if we accept any more suburban students or people from outside the city, we won't be able to keep our own students. So the priority would be, of course, city students. But what a wonderful dilemma that would be for this district to say, hey, we got to make some decisions to make sure our students, the parents that pay taxes in the city, have their kids go to these schools. And listen to this. If we had to make that decision, it would always be city first. But what do you think those parents who really want their kid to attend this military academy would think about doing before selling their house in the city, right? And by the way, you all know this. People choose where they want to live based on the school system. You ask any realtor, they'll tell you that. That's the first thing parents ask. So let's leave aside this issue of whether we would take a kid from Brighton or Pittsford or Riga. I'm talking about the parent who's thinking about sending his kid to a charter school or thinking about sending his kid to urban suburban or who's even thinking about, because he has the resources, of moving to Pittsford or Brighton or Riga. He or she decides, wait a second, I want my kid to go to, among other places, the military academy, the EPO at East, or at Edison, the new revised Edison, or SOTA, or School Without Walls. I'm not going to sell my house. I'm not going to pay the expensive private school tuition. So I think that it would be a good dilemma for us to be in, but more significantly, what a dilemma that would be for the parent who now has to scratch his head and say, I don't know that I want to leave the city. That'd be a good spot for us, I think. Yes?
Recommended a Regents diploma with emphasis on the STEM 4 plus one diploma path. Can you explain what that is?
So we felt it was important to have a focus on math and science. All right, to be college ready. And when we say the STEM 4 plus 1, STEM being science, technology, engineering, and math, really now they talk about it as STEAM, with arts added into it. The 4+1 path now means the four basic Regents exams. You need one science, one math, one history, one English, and one other Regents exam, which can be a second history, science, or math. All right, it's no longer the two histories required. So a 4+1 describes the Regents exams that are required. So we're recommending, you know, the Regents focus, all right, focusing on math and science. And we really looked at some of the private schools as a model of what we wanted to recommend. Everyone has to do 4 years of English, but our recommendation is also 4 years of math, 4 years of science. You know, students are not required to do 4 years of science, but we're saying at this school, that would be a recommendation that we would make. So really a heavy academic focus, college prep focus.
Any other questions from the meeting? Let me just add, I've been in government for many years, including stints at the DA's office, City Hall, going back to Mayor Ryan, and this is no exaggeration. This is the most substantive report I have ever read. Okay, and I know this gentleman has a question because he's gaping now, and I'm going to make sure he gets to ask his question. But no comments, just questions. But my opinion is, and this is America. I'm entitled to have an opinion. I've had some experience. This report not only articulates the opinions and experiences of the 20-something members of the committee, but more than any other report, maybe that doesn't say much about government, I don't know if that's your response, but more than any other report I've read in the decades that I've been in government service, this report is exhaustive in its attempt to understand what the community wants. And so in that respect, if this report does nothing else, and I promise, and the board promises the members of this committee, this is not going to, in government over the years, I've seen so many of these things collect dust, that will not happen. One way or another, someone's going to make a decision about what should happen with that. And we should all rejoice in that. We don't need another report that people, you know, bled sweat and tears, and there's nothing done with it. Whether you like the contents of this report or not, and I personally do, I find it very substantive, this report will not collect dust, and I make that promise to you. The board will deliberate over it and make a decision with respect to whether this idea should happen in this city. So so long as there are no other media questions, let me begin with you, sir. You gasped there.
Sure. Process question.
One, absolutely.
I've spoken to several members of the committee who told me they never saw the final draft of the report before it was posted on the board docs website on April 17th. So how can you tell us, that everyone on the committee made all of these recommendations? I've spoken to two, they said there were others who had never seen a final draft of the report before it was released.
When we're part of an organization or a committee of any type, and we're in a volunteer sort of status, we're counting on those individuals to come forward. We call the committee, the grand committee, we call the subcommittees. Everyone knows when to gather. Everybody knows that when we gather, we have these ideas that are exchanged. All the members, as charged by Mr. Van White, and that is in the report, were invited. They were indeed members of our committee. They knew the times, they knew the dates, and we had participation.
Okay, so in other words, you didn't pursue them all. So in fact, when it says the committee recommends many, many times in the report, in fact, the entire committee does not recommend any of these things because members of the committee did not sign off on the report. That's one point. Another point, in the report, it says, quote, RTA President Adam Urbanski has confirmed the support of RCSD Teachers Union in opening the school, unquote. I contacted Adam Urbanski. His response was, I have not seen any report. RTA only agreed to have teachers on the committee exploring the idea. Could you please explain the discrepancy there?
Well, I think that Mr. Todd Baxter and myself conducted interviews individually with these members. So we know what was said during those times. Todd, if you'd like to elaborate on that.
Did in fact confirm that the teacher, I wrote him and said, wait a minute, how did the union confirm this report, did you have a vote? I spoke to members of the executive committee of the RTA. They haven't seen the report. So how can you make that claim in this report that RTA President Adam Urbanski has confirmed the support of the teachers union in opening the school? How can you explain that comment?
So the president and I spoke personally, him and I, and the conversation was we were exploring this. We'd like input from all the key leaders in the community. Yes. We sought his input. The conversation between him, the president, and I was, we like the idea of options for the kids. We will have an opportunity to negotiate. He explained the 80% rule, that if you start a new school, there's opportunities for the contracts to be negotiated in those types of forums. So it wasn't a solidified, we're going to support this 100%. It was, we are not going to stand behind an option for kids. If this is another option, we'll have those options for the kids. And of course, we got to negotiate that with the contract. And go ahead. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, and to stand up here and to say we're being disingenuous with our comments or anything like that, or we didn't let certain committee members come in and give their input, you know, we knew we were eventually 60 days later going to stand behind a forum of reporters and community members that may or may not agree with this. So, you know, to make any accusations or insinuations that we desired everybody's input.
Saying that what you said in the report is false.
We desire everybody's input, and we couldn't publish the report without it because we knew we'd have to stand here in front of the public to give it.
What's in the report is false.
Well, listen, we have two other questions here. If this devolves into what is wrong with this report, and I don't think there's anything wrong with this report, we will have missed the point. We have something wrong in our community. Our kids don't have hope. And so the reason why... And dialogue has to be a two-way street. I don't think you can have effective dialogue. If somebody says something, then they walk out and they don't want to hear the response. Okay. All right. What is wrong in this community is this notion that we should always be looking for fault, always looking for blame. When we have kids who can't even write a report, much less read it, right? We have kids who don't even think about a future in the military or in employment, and we want to focus on what somebody said and what somebody didn't say. I got to tell you, this is not for media consumption. Hold on. Let me finish, and I'm gonna get to you. That's not fair, and that's not polite. But okay. I've said I'm gonna let you speak, but let me finish speaking. Thank you. If we focus on what other people did or did not do, and you see the conversation here is amongst adults. We're not talking about what happened to kids. Now let me add this last other point. I said to you, there's at least a year period before anything is implemented. I've said repeatedly, the operative phrase is, if the Board of Education approves, there'll be many conversations about this report. Matter of fact, I even said, the chairs of those committees may ask those people to come before them and entertain questions and ask the critical issues that the gentleman raised before he left. No one is suggesting that this is the be-all and end-all, that this is where the conversation ends, that there may be additional research that has to be done. This is the beginning. We had 26 people who said, I'll spend my time trying to figure out if this idea makes sense. That's all that's happened here today, folks. No one's taken any vote. No one's made a final decision. This is the beginning of a process. And by the way, we're glad you're here for the beginning of that process. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I won't make any comments if you said that. It's a bit of questions. One of the questions is that you stated that less than 10% of the students that go to the military school actually join the military. But what I think you need to actually be talking about, your research on, is the high percentage of military families that send their kids to military schools and how that implements the generational military aspect, or generally, statistically, a lot of students that go to military school have problems with behavioral problems and the juvenile system. So it's kind of like a drop-off place in many older cities where you have a military school. So how can this school be the answer for decades of dysfunctional city school district funded initiatives? How is this 1 year planning session going to solve any, if all, problems when we can barely survive in the capacity that our district is surviving in right now? I mean, we have a deficit budget, and you're trying to open up a separate school. You know, it just doesn't make sense to me to increase the amount of money that we're already not putting in the schools that we have already.
Let me say, and let me repeat, I think I made it very clear. We are not implementing anything this year. The deficit of what you spoke is for the 16-17 school year, right? Let's be clear about that. This is not, if you were here at the early part of the press conference, this is not for implementation this year. So let me finish. I listened to you. I'm responding. So this is not for this budget year. The planning that will take place will determine how, if the board decides to do this, how it would be financed in the context of the 17-18 budget. That's when the conversation will be at. Like any other program, you can't judge it in advance. We don't know what the resources are going to be next year. We didn't know what the state was going to give us this year. So it's a flexible thing. And then the other thing I will say in response to your comment is, how's it working for you? These decades of failure that you're not going to hear me argue about, how's what we've been doing working for you, right? The approach that we've taken, how many kids have graduated under this approach that we've taken over these years, this approach that we just do the same thing over and over again. Einstein described it as insanity, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. So if you want, and this is rhetorical, not to you, but if you want our children to continue to fail, to not see doors of opportunity open up to them, then I suggest we continue to do the same thing that we've always done. And that the characterization that you describe this district, to which I would not disagree, I would say to you, if you want things to be different, you have to do things differently. And finally, no one's saying we're going to do this. What we're saying is it makes sense. It's part of our fiduciary, our spiritual obligation to our children to attempt to do something that might make a difference in their lives. I don't know whether the board will support this a year from now. I don't know that that's going to happen. I do know this, that had we not engaged in that effort at East High School, a lot of people said, what are you doing? You don't have a university run a school? What are you doing? We took the time, did our due diligence. We did something dramatically differently, which is to plan on an effort that could change the trajectory of a school, of some students, of some family, of a community. That's what we're embarked upon today. That's the beginning of a journey that may ultimately mean we don't have a military school. But if you don't at least take that first step, which is what all this is, if you don't at least take that first step, I respectfully suggest you're condemning our children to the same future that you describe as ineffective for them today. Yes, sir. Oh, yes, sir.
Mr. Andre Evans, member of the committee. One of the things that we wanted to bring to the kids is that when you put on this uniform, when you join the military, you also join a set of values, a set of values that make and compose your leaders. And if you want peace, you have to instill those values of honor, those values of duty. It doesn't matter where, if you're a member of the military or the community, but it gives you a greater sense of being part of something whole called the community and also responsibility. So in the recommendation, what you'll find is a value-centered approach. It's not judgmental. It's not from a certain place, but it takes from a value of success. How it even draws on the Medal of Honor winners and their values and how to teach a strong value-centered approach so that those kids can go out back to their community and become leaders, not military members, but leaders in their own community, members of their own society, and help build a world that's better. And what you'll find 100% is that military is committed to community first, their success for their immediate neighborhoods, and usually you find that when they get involved, their neighborhoods, their families become better. So by not giving them the values that we grew up with in the military, you're denying them the opportunity to succeed because they're not learning it from anywhere else.
It's not that I'm completely against it. My question is more about those that percentage of students that do enter the military. I'm a veteran. My husband is a veteran. He served in the Army. My stepfather 20-year Marine veteran. I understand what it means to be a part of a military family. I am a military wife, so I understand the importance of having this and the implementation of this. My concern is that percentage of families that come and do join the Army and that do serve their country and that do go over to war. My husband still to this day suffers from PTSD, and the way that veterans outreach or the way that veterans are treated once they come home is drastically disappointing in this country. And I wouldn't want to put that on someone else's child. I know it's their own opinion, but looking at what it could possibly give them in a good way and a bad way, I think we do need to talk about that percentage that might come back or might join the military and how that does affect them and how we are going to hopefully be able to build that social-emotional development in them and that restorative justice part of them that isn't all just fight, go, and more of serve community and resilience. That's really...
Those are some good traits that you reference, by the way. But what you're discussing is your concern about the other effects of military service that have been researched. And again, let me repeat, this is the beginning of a process. I described for you 15 minutes ago the fact that we would submit this to Excellent Student Achievement, which is our instructional teaching committee that vets things from an instructional perspective. I also said we're going to submit this to finance. I also said there's a yet-to-be-described conversation with the community to make sure this is organic. So these concerns that you raise, the concerns that anybody might raise, this is not, and when I said no long statements, what I was trying to say is you clearly have plenty of opportunities to express your opposition or what I would describe, what I hear you saying is concerns that you have, and to make sure that there is a research response to those concerns. I get that. This is just the beginning of that process. This gentleman here has raised his hand for a while.
But I was wondering what the ethnic or racial breakdown of the committees were that were. I got statistics on the suburban versus urban breakdown and who was pro and kind of. But I would like to know that. And I don't know how you reconcile the idea that earlier you said that this is my second question.
Sure.
I believe that was the presenter said a main backbone of the program was the JROTC. And as far as No, I used to do JROTC in college. That is a major pipeline for the military. So I don't see how you reconcile those two statements.
So this is one of the things that our report hopes to do, and that is exchange knowledge, to increase knowledge of the community about what JROTC is and what ROTC is, the college program that you're talking about. So in JROTC, it's a much different type of program than ROTC, okay? And so ROTC is the backbone of military colleges and military high schools throughout the nation. And that JRO, in the college level, it's an ROTC. They produce officers to enter the military. That's their goal. They're doing those sorts of things that prepares people for combat. JROTC is not that. It is love, care, in a disciplined environment. And ladies and gentlemen, it works in other places. This is not a concept. This is not a new road that we're trying to go after. It works in other places. We simply see this opportunity being extended in Rochester may be one of the best things that this school district does.
And I know, ma'am, and then I'll get to you, sir.
Hold
on 1 second. The racial component. When I formed the committee, I wasn't a civil rights lawyer. You might be surprised to hear this. I wasn't thinking about, a racial balance. I just spent a two-week journey on the road promoting civil rights. I wasn't thinking about that. I was thinking about who were the best minds, had the best experiences that could offer a point of view that might inform our decision. One of the gentlemen sitting here is Captain Kyler. He happens to be African American. I didn't pick him because... he's African American, and I'm African American, and very proud of it. But what our kids needed, what the board needed, this is an advisory committee. It needed to be advised, and I wasn't. To be honest, I'm a civil rights lawyer. I wasn't thinking about race when I was doing it. Now I can tell you, Mr. Evans, he's on the committee. He happens to be African American. Mr. Baxter happens to be white. I cannot go down the list for you what the racial ethnicity was for each of those folks. I just can't.
But you do understand, as a civil rights lawyer, and yeah, you're studying civil rights, that there's kind of a different history of blacks in the relationship to military. For example, how do you reconcile the idea that Martin Luther King was very much against a lot of the military operations, so much that he said our military was the greatest purveyor of violence in the world at the time? How do you reconcile, like, would he be... Would he be pleased with us entertaining the idea of a military school?
Well, I don't know. I don't know what Dr. King would say about... I do too. I'm on the same page. You're preaching to the choir. He was clearly one of my eyes. Wouldn't be a civil rights lawyer if it weren't for him. I wouldn't have taken that journey. But let me tell you this. While Dr. King, you're absolutely right, did have problems with Vietnam and our engagement there, Dr. King was also very happy, along with Thurgood Marshall, that the military stepped in and got those children into Little Rock. So I think there is a balance to be said about history, and I don't want to engage in a lengthy conversation about what you think about Dr. King, what I think about Dr. King. Again, we ought to be focusing on the kids and what informed adults here today, black, white, green, blue, Latino, right? Our co-chair is Latino. Mary happens to be white. What they can do to inform the board. Now, to your point, we got a long ways to go. There are other questions that need to be answered. One of those questions might be, what would Dr. King say? To tell you the truth, I love Dr. King probably as much as you do, but right now, that is not relevant. It really isn't. What is relevant is what these folks hear, and don't shake your head, because I live and breathe Dr. King. I do. But I'm talking about hearing from adults today who know our children on the streets, in their homes. What do they think their children need? That's what I'm thinking. That's what Dr. King would want us to think about. What do our children need today? And that's what these folks are addressing. And that's what other people will address in the weeks and months to come. Yes, ma'am.
And I'm speaking as a person who served a career in the military. I was in for 20 years in the Army. I had retired. I also just retired from the Rochester City School District as a teacher.
Congratulations.
So I've been in the classroom, and I've been in the uniform, both careers. And I would like to know, isn't money better spent in reestablishing smaller, intimate middle schools and addressing all of our children's needs to help them with those values within themselves, rather than a military school, addressing all of the children's needs in the city school district?
I don't think it's an, you may look at this differently, and that's the beauty of this democracy. I don't think it's an either-or proposition. I don't think these approaches are mutually exclusive. I do agree with you that small, more intimate relationships between students. I just went to a pre-K program at number 7 school. Very small number of students. They knew the parents. They knew the teachers. No question that that kind of small, favorable adult-child relationship is always beneficial. No question about it. But I don't think we have to argue that point. At least I wouldn't with you. I would say you're right about that. I'll give you that. We need to develop more smaller populations of students, right? I get that. But at the same time, there's another door of opportunity that I think we have to be open-minded. You may not want to be, but I'm respectfully saying I'm open to what you're saying. I think you're right about having smaller student-adult population, more favorable ratios between students and adults. But I also happen to think that there are, you use the phrase, loving, caring people in our military who are instructors who could guide our children to successful futures out of the military. And maybe I can't convince you of that, but I would tell you this, you don't have to convince me that you're right about that. And so don't worry. If there's a model out there, this is the second initiative the board has offered in the last year of doing things dramatically different. East High School is an example of the model you're talking about. They broke it up into an upper house and lower house. Each student at East High School has an adult mentor or family leader. I get that. So it's not like, oh, we either do it at East and then we don't do the military academy. We can do it all. We have a budget of just short of $1 billion. $1 billion. We can do better. And we don't have to choose between one choice as an evil choice and one choice as a good choice. Yes, ma'am.
To what Ben White had mentioned earlier, this is just the beginning. I'm a student at Rank as we speak. I attend Franklin High School, I'm a senior, and I'm looking forward to going into the Marines. And honestly, like, it's okay to be concerned, especially as a parent, because I would put myself in your guys' shoes if I was older and I was a parent and a military school was an option. Just look at it as an option. Don't look at it as just a place to place kids in. at the end of the day, you know, there's a lot of students that don't know enough about the military or want to join the military, but they don't know if it's for them. And, you know, it's a good opportunity for future students who want to know about the military or want to learn the values or want to go into the military. In my opinion, if there was a military school open before or even now, I would be going. Because I value the military, I love the military, I love the service that they do, and it's just a good opportunity to have somewhere besides a regular school or the dorm type of school. And it's just, I don't know, it's something to be proud of. And it's, as a parent, or even me as a student, my little brother or my little sister was to be going to this military school, I would not only be there for him or her, but I would encourage it, because we don't know what will happen in the long term. And I feel like a lot of students need not the discipline, but they need the love, they need the care. And it would be just really great to have this military school open.
Thank you. I didn't even know she was coming. So, but it's good to hear different opinions. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, sir. Oh, whoever.
I just wonder if anybody looked at the military schools in terms of their success rate and that we're discussing that, but, you know, and compare that with other schools that offer discipline and loving care and support. Yeah, I think I like St. Benedict's in Newark, New Jersey, where the graduation rate is 96-98%. So, have you made comparisons of different schools that use discipline?
Well, we had 60 days to do this report, and thankfully we had a lot of experience on the committee. Myself, a graduate of a military junior college, and went on to another military college, and I took JROTC in high school too. What you'll find in many of these schools, I mean, we didn't do a direct comparison, but we looked at some of the things that we're doing. But one of the things you're going to find is many of the schools that are religious-based, for example, or are private nature, they take a lot of those values and concepts and from the military. I mean, they actually use the military as their way of encapsulating what they do, right? So when you look at a policeman in their uniform and what they have on their rank, the way they do things, that they've taken that from the military. And many of the other schools have done that too. So there needs to be more work done, of course. But I want you to know that when you look at all these other schools that are successful, and they may not put a military word or name on that, they're a reflection of many of the aspects of values, of care, of character that the military has.
Yeah, I think we could probably compare different schools and see, you know, which are doing best.
Absolutely. And you know, we'd be foolish not to use some of those good lessons learned, right? What I was amazed at is all the knowledge that we had in our committee, and it came out in different ways, right? And we want to use all those things. And I think that if this military school is voted upon and we go forward with it, we'll be taking some of those great lessons learned and incorporate those things. Every military school, every military high school, it is different. And if you doubt that, try to define what a military school is. There is no complete definition. You cannot define a military school. It's impossible because each one is different.
It's probably different because the leader is different. And let me just add, these folks that served on the committee, just for what it's worth, these are some of the most loving, caring, committed people that I know and that were recommended by other board members. So we're not in the... You may not trust the Board of Education enough to do this, but we would not create, if the board decides to do this, create a school that could not show the love for our children. And in fact, the irony here is, sir, that's why we're doing this, because the results don't suggest that our children are loved enough to be successful. So we want to make sure that we create those models that embrace children where they're at. And again, let me say, if the school opens up, it's going to be enrolled with students whose parents want them to be there. It's not, I'm not making that decision. And if a parent decides, you know what, I want my kid to go to this school, shouldn't we as Americans, as parents ourselves, allow a parent to make that decision? Someone might oppose this military school, but if a parent who's raised their child from the womb thinks that this is best for their child, and the child wants to be there, and we have loving and caring and committed people, why wouldn't the district support such a model? Besides the fact that maybe something happened in a war 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 20 years ago, but if today a parent thought this is what was best for their child, and the child wanted to do it, it's an informed decision by the parent, why would we as a district stand in the way of that? That's a rhetorical statement, not wanting necessarily an answer. But go ahead. Yes, sir.
I understand. I mean, the school district, using the best state-of-the-art pedagogical and philosophical principles, is supposed to make basic decisions about what is appropriate in the school system. It's not up to any parent to say, well, I want this particular program, therefore I get it. The school district would not, although I'm sure that lots of people in the district would love to have a religious academy within the district. It's obviously impossible on pedagogical as well as political grounds. So
legal
it's
grounds.
Not simply a matter of why that I'm getting it. What bothers me the most about this report, which I find very deficient, and I've looked over lots of reports too in my career, lots of environmental impact statements, other things which are extremely thorough. I don't see that kind of thoroughness here by any means. I would say that the biggest deficiency, though, is the failure to give weight to educational philosophy. The best educational philosophy as understood in the 21st century. I would say that one way of approaching this would be to compare the ideals that are in the draft code of conduct and compare it to the military ethos, the system of military discipline. You say that there are a lot of loving people and everything within the ranks, and I do not dispute that. I was in the ranks, and I know that there are lots of people who are loving and caring and so forth, who want the best for others. That's not the question. The question is, what is the philosophical and educational framework that brings out those aspects of humanity in the best possible way? That's the central question that any study of a possible military academy has got to come to grips with. The report doesn't do it at all.
Well, in defense of the folks that did the report, as Colonel Miranda said, they were only given 60 days. So that's their failure to cover that particular point is a reflection of our decision, not theirs. I'm sure these are educated, sophisticated, not only loving and committed individuals, but many of them have advanced degrees, PhDs, years of experience in the field with children. They get that there's a whole another way to look at this, but there just wasn't the time. Now, that doesn't mean, as I said countless times already, that there will not be an opportunity. If you want to come to an ESA meeting where they're talking about the philosophical underpinnings of such a program, and you want to offer a contrary view, you can do that. This isn't the decision. The report isn't the decision. The report sets us on a path to make a decision. That's all it does. So if you want to offer up a contrary view or something that you think is deficient in the report, you'll have an opportunity to do that.
What I'm concerned about is, will we have an or some decisive actions taken by the board?
Oh, absolutely. I think I indicated that multiple times.
Keep saying that this is just the beginning of a process. However, every time we look, the process has advanced that much further. And it seems to be there's a steamroller effect here.
Well,
towards a vote by the board, which will make this a fait accompli.
Well, see, now you're looking in the rearview mirror. Maybe you saw something in the rearview mirror that happened in the past, but none of that has happened in this case. And in fact, when this press conference began, I've said it multiple times, it's going to be vetted before ESA. They would have a chance to ask questions of the committee. You would have a chance to hear the ESA committee. Finance. I also said, and I think I said it multiple times, there's going to be an organic conversation with the community, because the law, talks about community-based schools. So to say it again, this is the beginning of a journey. There's been no steamroll. I asked them to put together a report within 60 days. They did that. I think it's an exceptional report that certainly can, at the very least, begin to frame the conversation about whether this makes sense or not. Ultimately, as I said, the Board of Education will have to vote. But as I said repeatedly, before that, there'll be plenty of opportunities in ESA, finance, and in some kind of community vetting about whether this idea makes sense or not. And then ultimately, just so that we're clear, at least four board members are going to have to say, we like this idea. If they don't, then the idea won't go anywhere. What I promised this group that works so hard and genuinely and sincerely, and I would say people need to back off any statements that suggest they didn't do this with integrity. There's no reason behind any statement like that. And you will discourage people from stepping up and serving beyond the capacity for which they've been previously asked to do. And you know something about that. Serving beyond the capacity, doing things above and beyond. And then to have somebody call into question your integrity, we got to step back from those comments. I'm not talking about you. I didn't say you did it. But earlier today, someone said something that, you know, when you're serving, okay, you can disagree about the service, but you shouldn't be disagreeable about the people. That wasn't with respect to what you said. We can do this with dignity, and we can do it on the issue. And the issue is whether this makes sense or not. And there are a lot of different conversations that will come before there's any final vote. I assure you that. Yes, sir.
I'm looking over the charge of the ad hoc committee, and it talks about exploring the feasibility of opening a military academy and the curriculum and methods and so forth going to be used. Was there ever a study or a determination as to whether even having a school, a military school, is advisable? So it seems to me as though the committee is looking at this and was formed in a way that it's in response to, we've already decided we need a school, how do we do it? And I'm wondering, was there ever any background study done before you even got to that point as to deciding whether we should even look into the possibility of starting a military academy?
Well, I'd have to read the charge again, but the charge was approved by the entire board. I could.
I'm not questioning the charge. Who wrote it? I have no question about this report.
Okay.
What I'm looking for is the preamble. There's no preamble as to even determine whether we even want to consider whether we have an academy. We've already made that determination by setting up this committee with the charge that you did.
What we determined was we ought to have an examination as to whether this was feasible or not. I listened to you. Let me respond. You know, government is the worst for just making decisions about decisions. One of the reasons why this district struggles is because on some occasions we don't make the decisions that need to be made. In this case, and I apologize if I misconstrued your comment, and again, I apologize, you're suggesting that we should have first examined whether we wanted to examine the idea of whether to have a military academy or not. If that's what you're saying, I'll take the heat for that. These gentlemen, this committee of 26 people, don't take the heat for that. I take responsibility for that. There's no time for that. There's no time to decide whether we should engage in a process that seeks to only determine whether this is feasible or not. The question had to be, is this idea feasible or not? And then the board could respond to that. Children, this is not hyperbole. Children are dying. We live in the most impoverished community. Our children live in the most impoverished community in our nation, right? We have less than a 50% graduation rate. Although it's gone up, it's not gone up. We look at military schools and other models that have graduation rates in excess of 80%, 90%, right to our west. So for me, I can only speak for me, I can't speak for the board on this issue because the board hasn't made a decision. For me, it would not be responsible to not look at other options that might give our children a venue for success. Again, no final decision has been made, but there's a conversation about it. We had to begin the conversation. I wasn't going to have a conversation about whether we should have a conversation about whether it's feasible or not. Too many lives at stake.
That's not what I'm saying.
Okay, fair enough.
I'm sure maybe I'm assuming something that I'm assuming that it just took place. When the school board decided to start the School of the Arts, so
yes,
it would have seemed to me as though there had to be some starting point there as to whether we should even consider such a school and why we would need it and what it would do. This is not done here. I don't mean did you?
So where did the idea come from?
That's right. I mean, where'd the idea come from? But not only that, it seems to me when you start the study, you've got to determine whether you even want it.
Well, that was the whole point of the study.
That's not what the chart says.
And that's not what the report says. Determine whether it was feasible or not.
Feasibility seems to me is whether it's possible to do. Not whether you want it.
Okay. All right. So a report has been made talking about the feasibility of it. Now, the board, and I think I've said this repeatedly, will decide whether they want to do it or not based on the information that was provided. So now they have information to, in part, just from the report, much more to be discussed. Now they have information upon which they can make an informed decision.
Does the report, and I haven't seen anything in it, and you can point me to it, is there anything in there that says this is what a military academy will provide? It seems to me we're operating under a lot of assumptions, but does it anywhere in there does it say this is what a military academy will provide? You talk about discipline, but you can get discipline anywhere. The point is, why do you want to have a military academy?
I can tell you that if you, within the district, if you ask administrators and principals about military schools, the word you hear over and over again is the opportunity, right? So they push everything aside. They push the use of weapons in marching, in drilling. They push that. In fact, in a society where that is something that will cause a young man or young woman to get expelled, you would think that that would be a concern from the administrators. They don't. They want that opportunity. And they see these successes going on throughout the network. We don't sit here in a vacuum in Rochester and say, this is us, this is how we do things, and we shouldn't look at other ways of doing things, right? So as an educator, I come from Oklahoma. I went to the Citadel. I went to New Mexico Military Institute. There are good things and bad things about that, and when I enter Rochester, I have something to provide. And so when you go around the country and you ask administrators, they always say, I wouldn't stop this opportunity for our students, okay? So the report does have things that the military school will provide. I mean, again, it will provide the materials that are there. It will provide a military style, okay? And some of these things are debatable as whether or not you're going to be able to define those things. But again, it comes down to the opportunity, right? We should be given the opportunity. And we can discuss, these things maybe later on, and obviously have time for that to happen. But that's what comes up from administrators. They push all those things aside, and it comes down for giving all the opportunities for kids.
But I guess my question is, my question is that the committee was not charged to determine whether this is something
desired. Let me read, and all of us are getting this report for the first time, including the board. The first question on page 13, overall recommendations. Question one, is it, and this is my fault, I've been talking about feasibility, but listen to the words. Is it feasible and desirable for the Rochester City School District to open a military academy to provide enhanced educational opportunities primarily to the students and families of the Rochester City School District and to the students and families of Monroe County? The answer and results were yes. Based on the work completed by the advisory committee, a military high school in Rochester is not only operationally feasible, but also desirable. So whether you and I agree on the issue of feasibility, it's clear they were looking at desirability, whether we should even have this. So again, you and I might disagree on that. It sounds like you might disagree, but they did answer the question based on the people they talked to, the desirability question. They do find it that it's desirable. Now it's up to the board, through other opinions like yours, as to whether it is desirable, whether it is feasible. That process has just begun.
Possibly some parents. go and visit a high-functioning military school in another city or another state. So some people learn best by viewing, some people learn best by doing, to really get the aspect of how it feels, how it's represented, how it's going to be, and then transferable for our Rochester City School District. Will there be an opportunity or discuss about an opportunity for that in the future?
I think that idea makes sense. We just have to determine whether it's feasible or not, but I should have mentioned this earlier, and I think, Erica, you would agree with me on this. When we were looking for people to serve on the committee, and again, there's a listing of the people, and I just wasn't even thinking about it, but it's very diverse. Hector Alvarado is Latino. This gentleman is Latino. There were African Americans. But let me say, I called Erica up. I called the parent. She's, for those of you who don't know, she's the head of our parent advisory council. She's just here as a parent. But I called her up in that capacity, and I said, you know, we're looking for people to impanel this committee. Do you have any suggestions? And she offered some suggestions. So, again, on the issue of desirability and feasibility, they've taken their stab at it. We will read it, we will digest it, and we will move forward and have a conversation about it. I think that's, whatever you think about military, I got to tell you, I think that's good government. I do think that's good government. I don't think that this is something, you may disagree about a military academy, but to ask citizens at every level, including our parent rep, including police officers, experienced educators, military people, what do you think? Give us you know how many times in government, from Albany to Washington, they don't give two hoots about what you think and don't even think about impaneling committee to talk about desirability, much less functionality or feasibility? This is a good way for government to operate. And by the way, I'm down to talk to you as long as you need to talk about this, and there'll be other opportunities. This is good government. You may not like military. This is exceptional government, and I hope, whether you agree with the military approach or not, this is the Board of Education, the Rochester School District, planning, deliberating in an open, transparent way so that the children get the opportunities that they need. Yes, ma'am.
He stressed it a lot because there's a lot of questions to be asked and answered, and there's a lot of ideas to make sure. We don't know what's going to happen in the long run, but our ideas should be open, and we should have that mindset where we think, yes, it's okay to think about what outcomes can happen, what bad outcomes, but also the good outcomes, what good can come from establishing a military academy.
I think we're done, and I appreciate everybody coming. Thank you, gentlemen, ma'am, for coming. I appreciate it. Thank you.